Everyone, I'm Dr. Seema Rohila, Professor of Radio Diagnosis, Pandit B.D. Sharma, Postgraduate Institute of Medical Sciences, Rohtak, Haryana. Today I'll be talking about hippocampal characteristics among children with calcified neurocystic cirrhosis. NCC, as you know, is one of the most common parasitic infections of the central nervous system in the tropical countries, causing epilepsy. The majority of children with NCC have a well-controlled seizure, but some have refractory seizures. In a developing country, apart from prolonged febrile seizures, NCC has been considered to be an initial precipitating factor for the development of hippocampal sclerosis, and this dual existence of calcified NCC and hippocampal sclerosis is often attributed to refractory seizures among children with calcified NCC. Studies from Brazil have demonstrated that there was a significant association between calcified NCC and ipsilateral hippocampal sclerosis. It remains an enigma if the association between the calcified NCC and hippocampal sclerosis is a mere coincidence or does it indeed have a cause-effect relationship. There is positive data on Indian children with calcified neurocystic cirrhosis, and hence this study was carried out. It was a prospective study conducted among children with epilepsy in the age group of 3 to 14 years who were diagnosed with calcified NCC and were attending pediatric neurology clinic of the Tertiary Care Hospital of North India. And these children was defined as those who were having two or more unprovoked seizures at least 24 hours apart. The diagnostic criteria for NCC were as per Bell-Buterbaugh-based definition of NCC. Children with single or multiple calcified lesions whose previous radiological scans revealed evidence of active NCC were included in the study. Children with progressive neurological disease, a chronic systemic illness like chronic renal failure, chronic liver disease, and those with developmental delay or intellectual disability were excluded from the study. Children with active NCC were also excluded from the study. Patient information sheet was provided, written information consent taken, and age at onset of epilepsy, frequency of seizures, seizure-free interval, doses, and anti-helminthic duration was recorded. Patients showing evidence of calcified NCC with prior serial imaging evidence of active NCC were enrolled in the study and were subjected to MRI-based protocol and EEG. Sleep deprived electroencephalography recording using 10 to 20 international electrode system was performed. All MRI investigations were performed on 3 Tesla MR scanner of GE make. 31 children were enrolled in total for the study. The total number of calcified lesions were studied concerning the number, laterality, lobar distribution, associated gliosis, and nidus, which were seen as hypointensity within hyperintense calcification on filter phase images of SWAN. The calcified NCC lesions were examined for the presence or absence of hippocampal sclerosis, nidus, and perilesional gliosis. Hippocampal atrophy was considered as borderline if the difference in the volumes of the two sided hippocampi was 10 to 20% and was considered as definite if this difference in volume was more than 20%. The measurement of hippocampal volume was semi-automated. The outline of hippocampus was placed manually in three planes, and once this was done, volume was calculated using this input by ReadyView software in ADW workstation of GE Main. All the data was entered in Microsoft Excel, IBM SPSS version 15, and statistical analysis was done. Categorical variables were expressed as numbers, that is percentages, and continuous variables were expressed as mean in terms of standard deviation or median in terms of interquartile range. Clinical and radiological features were correlated using Spearman correlation coefficient. Out of the total case, 31 cases enrolled, 26 children had well-controlled seizures, 1 child had moderately controlled seizures, and 4 had poorly controlled seizures. 30 were treated with albendazole for 28 days. Majority of them were vegetarian. Among the 31 children with calcified neurocystic cirrhosis, only 1 child had ipsilateral hippocampal sclerosis, which was visible. 13 children had either borderline hippocampal atrophy, that is 10 to 20% difference in volumes of the two sides, or clear hippocampal atrophy, that is more than 20% difference. Of these 13 cases of borderline hippocampal atrophy or atrophy, 8 had calcified NCC on the same side, 4 had calcified NCC on the opposite side, and 1 had calcified NCC on both the sides. The hippocampal volume among the enrolled children in the age group of 3 to 6 years was 2.84 plus minus 0.16 cubic millimeter and on the right side, and 2.73 plus minus 0.37 cubic millimeter on the left side. Similarly, hippocampal volumes in the age group of 7 to 14 years was 3.1 plus minus 5.8 cubic millimeter on the right side, and 2.95 plus minus 0.66 cubic millimeter on the left side. Out of 6 cases with highest percentage asymmetry of hippocampal volumes, 4 showed more T2 values of hippocampi, which were comparatively atrophic. Among 31 children, 27 had nidus within the lesions and 21 had variegation crisis. There was no correlation between the seizure frequency and presence of cleosis in the calcified neurocystic sarcosis. Similarly, there was no significant correlation between the number of calcified lesions and absolute hippocampal volumes. There was no correlation of bilateral hippocampal volume with presence of nidus or cleosis. This is a table showing the seizure characteristics of children with the calcified NCC. And here it is showing the number of calcified NCC, whether they were single, two, three to five, or more than five. And this table shows the correlation between various clinical and radiological characteristics among the children with calcified neurocystic sarcosis. This is a figure of one of the patients which was showing clear-cut hippocampal atrophy of the left side. This is a CT image showing calcified lesion in the left parietal area. This is a filtered phase image of the swan showing both the phases hyper-intense and with the hypo-intense nidus within. The hyper-intense lesion is the calcified part and the hypo-intense dot within is the scoliosis. And this is a clear image showing the lesion is hypo-intensity. These are the images which are showing volume entry, and this is the volume of the right-sided hippocampus, which is 2.121 cubic centimeter, and of the left-sided hippocampus, which is 1.217 centimeter cube, showing clear-cut left-sided hippocampal atrophy. And this is oblique T2-weighted coronal image showing the hippocampal atrophy of the left side. The present study found that 42% of children with CNCC had demonstrated hippocampal atrophy. Majority of calcified NCC lesions in the present cohort triggered nidus and perilesional cleosis. There was no correlation between the hippocampal volume and the number of calcified lesions, presence of perilesional cleosis, or presence of nidus within the lesion. Hence, children with calcified NCC have prevalent epileptogenic focus like hippocampal atrophy and perilesional cleosis. Hippocampal sclerosis has been reported to be associated with calcified NCC in large number of studies. The present study showed that only 1 out of 31 children with calcified NCC had clear evidence of hippocampal sclerosis. It was technically difficult to delineate the exact boundaries of hippocampus in young children. There is no standard cutoff to define hippocampal atrophy in children, as normal evaluatory standards have not been developed. Hippocampal atrophy was defined as asymmetry of more than 20% within the right and left sides. Using this cutoff, we detected 42% of our children with calcified NCC who had borderline hippocampal sclerosis and or clear. That is more than 20% difference in the volumes of hippocampal atrophy. In a study from Brazil, it was found that in patients with single NCC, the mesial temporal lobe epilepsy hippocampus sclerosis, the lesion matched the site in which the hippocampus sclerosis observed in 74.1% patients. In our study, out of 13 cases of hippocampal asymmetry, 8 had exudated lesions, out of which 7 were single lesions. Of the 4 cases with contralateral lesions, atrophy of the left hippocampus was seen in 3 cases. And this could be explained by the fact that the left-sided cerebral hemisphere is the dominant hemisphere and is having more circuitry connections to both the right as well as the left hemispheres. And this also lends credence to the theory that in cases of NCC, not only the NCC lesions or the seizure per se, but some inflammatory process which travels along the circuitry also play a role in the development of hippocampal sclerosis. In the fourth case, with an equal number of lesions on right as well as left sides, the left hippocampus was atrophic, again maybe due to the prominent dominant feature of the left cerebral hemisphere with more connections with the both sides of the brain. The study findings are comparable to the Brazilian study. However, in our study, most of the lesions leading to ixilateral hippocampal atrophy were in frontal parietal lobes, unlike the Brazilian study, where 85% were in temporal lobes. Presence of perilesional cleosis around the calcified NCC has been associated with higher seizure frequency and seizure recurrence over 12 months follow-up period. As 2/3 of our well-controlled patients demonstrated perilesional cleosis, our study suggested that isolated presence of perilesional cleosis cannot be considered as a predictor for seizure recurrence among children with calcified NCC. The present study had limitations of small sample size, cross-sectional study type design, and lack of ACE-matched control. In the radiological assessment, T2 relaxometry, which would have helped if there is an associated component of mesial temporal sclerosis, was not performed considering the lack of normative age norms for comparison. Moreover, the volumetric measurements of hippocampus were semi-automated, which might be prone to few subjective errors, and the same is acknowledged. The results of the present study need to be interpreted in the context of this limitation. Further longitudinal studies are recommended with a larger sample size to look for clinical correlation and evolution of hippocampal volumetry with time. So we concluded that epileptogenic focus like hippocampal atrophy and perilesional cleosis are prevalent among Indian children with calcified neurocystic sarcosis. These findings might have implications on the decision of taking anti-epileptic drugs among well-controlled children with calcified neurocystic cirrhosis. Further studies with larger sample size and longer follow-up are suggested. So this is a list of references which we refer to. And thank you very much for your kind attention.